Wonderful. I make that 11, so let's kick off today. I'd like to welcome everyone to our webinar on effective cybersecurity for recruiters. We're thrilled to have you here today. And before we dive in, just a really quick note that you're very welcome to submit your questions throughout the presentation. You should see a Q&A button at the bottom of your screen, so feel free to type your questions in there at any point as they come to you. We'll go through all questions at the end of the session. And we really would like to hear from you. So go ahead and pop those questions to us. So our speakers today are going to share their practical insights into the recruitment industry and specifically the cybersecurity measures that can keep you safe. So Maxime Bly is the Chief Membership and Innovation Officer at the REC. Having previously held senior leadership roles at the CBI, Maxime has an in-depth knowledge of what UK businesses need to succeed. Jason Price works with me at Red Helix. He has been here for 6 years and he provides hands-on support to protect businesses, large and small, from cybercrime. He looks after some of our clients in the recruitment industry, as well as other sectors. This means he can apply insights from one to another, allowing everyone to benefit. So let me hand over to Maxine to share her insight into the situation as she sees it today.
Oh, thanks very much, Michelle. And hi, everyone. It's a pleasure to be on the call. What I thought I would do is just set out some of the operating context that we're hearing from the industry and from our surveys, because there's still a lot of uncertainty out there and change coming. And I think it's really useful to sort of think about your plans around cybersecurity in that regard and make sure you're controlling what you can. So if we start off on the economy, there's lots of noise about the economy at the moment, you know, flat growth, recession. It's certainly been a cautious start to the year. But we would say that's actually been the picture for about a year now. We have seen a slight further drop in hiring activity at the start of 2024, particularly for permanent workers. But I would caveat that by saying that a lot of this is in comparison to that sort of post-pandemic sugar rush when there was that real kind of boom for the industry. And actually, activity levels overall remain relatively high by comparison to pre-pandemic, and unemployment is low. But it's certainly cautious. You know, client businesses are telling us that they're not feeling sort of sure-footed enough to jump into the kind of investing and hiring that they want and need to do to meet their growth ambitions, because the UK economy has essentially been stuck in one place for 18 months. And I think that's creating this feeling that the jobs market is actually at a bit of a standoff with the wider economy. So there's underlying demand there, but employers and candidates are sort of waiting to see what develops before committing to new roles. So it's a bit cat and mouse, and we know that to unlock that, growth is needed from somewhere. So we've got a spring budget this week, tomorrow, in fact, that we're hoping will prioritise growth measures and incentivise businesses to invest. And of course, we're in an election year, so waiting for manifestos. But it's important that whoever's in power has a good and clear industrial strategy and approach for unlocking growth. And if they do that, you know, whoever's in power, if they can get those kind of policies right to unlock growth and inflation continues to fall as we expect it will do, we know that hiring demand will come back strongly, and that businesses will be quick to hire, and that then lack of labour supply sort of remains an issue, and that gets exacerbated, because really, the labour market shouldn't be as tight as it is at this stage of the economic picture. You know, candidate shortages will come back very quickly. And I think in that regard, for our industry, candidate relationships are really important. And I'll come on to sort of why I think that matters. At a more macro level, we know big tech change, generative AI is kind of rapidly changing the world of work and roles, as well as the kind of tasks and business models within our own industry, and that there are big demographic shifts that firms are having to respond to. There's increasing responsibilities expected on global issues, so net zero requirements, D&I, data security, one kind of good example, all starting to come through more strongly in procurement and into client practices. So it is a time of change. I think changing expectations from clients, you know, we're hearing of increasingly tight and rigorous procurement practices related to recruitment. Changing expectations from candidates, again, around how and when and where they work, and a new government with new policies that we'll have to adapt to. And when there's lots of uncertainty out there, I think, then it is all about controlling your controllables. And I think there's probably just three kind of takeaways for our industry then in the context of cybersecurity. One, this point that kind of getting the right candidates is really what's going to drive service. So big focus on being able to tap into and access new candidate pools, retrain into client sectors, redesign jobs. They're the big things that the industry is going to have to grasp, as well as the way we present and evolve the recruitment offer. And data is just a huge part of that. You know, it means really effective use of CRM. It means candidate relationships are really important. And clearly kind of knowing their data is safe with you is a kind of fundamental part of that. The second is just around kind of tech adoption strategies for our industry. So recruitment is a human professional service, but technology is transforming practices, you know, through AI, through blockchain, through proper use of data analytics. And we know that kind of firms, regardless of size, are going to have to spend some real time on kind of prioritizing that and thinking it through, regardless of kind of the point of the tech journey they're on at the moment. Recognizing, of course, that it's a balance, you know, understanding candidate needs, providing personalized guidance remains essential. That's our differentiator as an industry. But some focus on tech adoption is critical. And then finally, just on the sort of the business operations side, we know that a lot of our members have been using this slightly quieter period to sort of consider some of their back office functions, to look at their digital transformations or change programs and effectively get match fit for the market picking up speed again. And I think that can feel difficult when cash is tight, but really important for the longer term in terms of being as productive as possible and setting yourself up properly for this kind of return to growth. And again, as part of that, I think then making sure that you've got the relevant cyber and data security in place is a sort of essential foundation that sits under that. So really looking forward to hearing Jason sort of tell us a little bit more, I guess, about how we can get those foundations right as an industry. And that's me, I think.
Thanks, Lexi. Companies from all sectors and sizes are facing a rising tide of cybercrime. But those who hold personal information are specially targeted. I mean, the recruitment industry, for example, holds a vast amount of data on their clients and face persistent and sophisticated cyber attacks. Agencies often work with high-profile individuals holding private data, such as salaries and employment requirements. And these are extremely sensitive pieces of information. And a security breach could cause irreparable damage to your brand as an agency. And as this slide illustrates, there have been a number of successful breaches and they have risen, but also the requirements of cyber insurers have increased. So really, when we look at it, we often see there's two kind of types of customer. One who's unfortunately suffered a breach and they're going out there buying anything they can buy to try and fix a problem. And as we all know, when we kind of panic buy, you don't always get the best things for your environment or suitable to you. But on the flip side, you've got those who don't really know where to start. And if you've got nowhere to start, no one to advise you, it really can be very difficult. However, we know there are tools and pieces of information out there that are there to help and guide you. The NCSC have provided a number of these tools and pointers of where to start. And we can work with you to get you to your end goal. There are five areas that we're going to cover today. They're around protecting your users, protecting your brand, which as we've seen is becoming very, very important and a lot more people are talking about it, but also protecting your remote workers, how they access your data when they're moving around or when they're working from home. Because as we've seen over the last couple of years, that remote access has become more critical and securing that remote access has become more critical. But following on, protecting your IT and protecting your data. So we start with the security awareness. And I'm sure it's not going to be any surprise to you that business email compromise is seen by criminals as the easiest route into an organization. Because standard security products are easily bypassed by a phishing attack. Because with phishing attacks, quite often there isn't any malware or anything in the email to indicate that it's actually something dangerous. And so your traditional tools don't really see it as a threat. And so it goes past, and then unfortunately, when it's gone past all your traditional tools, because it's an email with nothing in, somebody opens it and it's into your environment. And it's kind of bypassed, like I said, everything that's there. And what we have, especially the need now, is to have users to be able to know what the red flags are and what to look out for. And this is where an effective and relevant security training policy is necessary. As we were saying just then, phishing emails are becoming probably the most common way and the most common cybersecurity threat. However, it's not all doom and gloom. We can take this with a sort of a multi-layered approach. So you do the test phishing of somebody, you train them to understand what they didn't do the first time, then you phish again, then you repeat in that cycle. And what your users are learning really is what real-world phishing attacks look like and how to deal with them and things to spot, but also gives you a vast of information to your users, to your colleagues, about what other security awareness topics there are, say social media and things like that. But as this graph here shows, each of the sectors within the different industries out there, we've got a 12 million user base. So this community, every single one of these users and companies have a thing called a phish prone percentage. What that is actually to see where your maturity level is in terms of whether you're opening suspect emails and that kind of thing. But the crucial bit here is it's based on your industry. So you can see how you compare to others in your industry. This is just a very basic example of where you start. And after 12 months, pretty much everyone we've worked with so far is around this area, which is pretty good because they've gone from a level of not knowing anything to actually being very suspicious, which is kind of where we were 12, 18 months ago when we started working with this product, where our teams didn't have really any proper cybersecurity awareness training. But thankfully they have, because a few months back, we got an email from one of the vendors in our supply chain, and it went to our finance team. And when that finance employee opened the email, there was some things in there which actually were red flags. But because they've been on their training, they were kind of automatic suspicious when things in there like urgency. Because in this email, it was saying, you must change your banking details to reflect this. This invoice needs to be paid straight away. And they're looking at thinking, actually, this is just kind of a classic red flag of what I've been trained on. And then because they've been trained, they've taken a breath, looked at the email, gone up to the email address, hovered over it, and that email address was spelt wrong. What the attacker had done is then instead of having one T in the customer's company's name, it had two. But to the naked eye, normally, you wouldn't have seen that because you say, oh, it's a company. It looks very similar. Right, it's fine. But because they've been sort of trained on how to do this with a cyber awareness, security awareness training, they've been automatically suspicious because of the, let's say, the urgency, but also now knowing what to look and what to check. And because they did that, you know, that saved us a lot of pain and a lot of embarrassment if they had clicked on it and transferred that money. Because we have seen a number of instances in a lot of the industries like yourselves where people haven't been aware what to look out for and clicked on things, and then it's a very difficult process. And next, we're going to speak for protection. And this has become more and more important as well, where we've seen a lot of organizations who aren't really fully aware of what systems and services are running under their domain. And whether that's shadow IT, somebody put things online just to sort a problem, or a long-term project which has ended and people have forgotten to go back and tidy up after them. And we see this a lot, where a lot of organizations are spun up, especially now with cloud services, are spun up a server for a particular event or a campaign and then forgotten to take it down or forgotten to close it all down properly. And so there's things out there that we don't know there and you don't know there, but they are there. And you really can't fix and secure things that you don't have visibility of. And we've run discoveries for a number of companies on their public facing assets, so things in the cloud, for example. And it's shown some really interesting, actually some really worrying results as well, of things which systems that have been up and running for say 4 or 5 years, but the actual campaign or the project finished 3 years ago. And so let's say, if it's not somebody's on their job to check every single day, these things get missed. But also, with over 250,000 new hosts coming online every single 24 hours, it's not a shock that cyber criminals are using lookalike domains to cheat people into using their lookalike domain as opposed to the real one. And you can imagine what happens there if somebody's gone onto the site, oh, it looks like it should be the real one, and they've clicked in to a login box and they've just entered their details. Well, they've just given their details away. So this is a real and very real and common threat now. And for an example of this, one of our customers who we brought on board with the brand trust service, within 2 weeks had found 500 lookalike domains that were virtually the same as theirs. And yeah, that took us aback and we did sort of gasp a bit. But the more worrying is they all could have been damaging, and 30 of them were ready to be brought online that were exact copies of their domain. That's all been dealt with, thankfully, and any issue that could have happened was averted. But because we were running this, they were able to see it. If we hadn't run it, they wouldn't have known, and that could have been very difficult for their brand as it goes forward. But also, what we're sort of seeing now is a lot of the agencies and governments are now coming on board with this because it's getting a lot more attention. Things like the PCI SSC, so the payment card industry, have mandated by March 2025 that any company handling credit cards or other payments must have DMARC in place. And also with Google and Yahoo, they've announced a similar sort of thing where their measures now, you have to have DMARC in place, because if you're trying to send around sort of 5,000 emails a day, and they might be going to these Google servers, if you don't have that authentication in place, it'll get dropped and it won't get processed. And this is something that we've been kind of more aware of in the last year or so. Before that, no one really was that aware of DMARC, but now it's becoming more and more important for industry. And we've recently been speaking with a client who, a bit like a lot of people, hadn't heard of DMARC, didn't even know what it was, and so it wasn't on his priority list. But they noticed that a lot of their customers, they were emailing on, say, a campaign or a mail shop, but they weren't getting the emails. So after a heck of a lot of work and investigation, he'd found out that actually the emails weren't being processed because they'd hit their 5,000 limit. And so he had to go rush around trying to get a DMARC solution in place because he wasn't aware of this mandate that was from February 24, that after that period, you have to have DMARC in place if you're going to be sending, like say, about 5,000 emails per day. And the crucial thing is that you might not think you email 5,000 users on a Google platform. However, a lot of companies use Google's email services, so that still counts.
And if I might just chip in there, Jason, I hadn't appreciated how important DMARC was before joining the company, nor would I have known if I had it in place in my previous companies that I've worked for. And there are actually online free tools. There's a particularly good one from the NCSC, so the National Cybersecurity Agency, where you can, if you just Google that and Google free DMARC checker, you can see if you have it in place or not. So even if you're not in IT, you can take that to your IT team and say, look, we don't have this, but we really do need to get to work on this. And that's all free.
Thank you, Michelle. Yeah, exactly that. And it is very common. A lot of people haven't come across it. And we're seeing quite an interesting number of people, whether it's in recruitment, whether it's in finance, a lot of companies not have it in place because, like I say, if you've not heard of it, it's not the top of your priority. However, going forward, it will need to be part of your priority because we're seeing more and more mandates and legislations and acts coming in over the next 18 months will insist that you do have it to carry out business. And now we're going to the accessing your systems remotely. Well, I think everybody's come across VPN at some time. Back in the day, you know, this service has been around since the 1990s, and it hasn't really changed in its technology since then. But I think we all know that businesses have changed a heck of a lot since then. And we did relying a lot more and depending a lot more on cloud applications and resources that sit outside of your VPN, your traditional on-prem system. And so what we're seeing is a lot of people who are trying to access these digital resources are getting affected by the fact that they've had to go into their environment, so into their firewalls, and then out to the different locations. So they're all experiencing like bandwidth strain. because you're putting all of your stuff in there, then you're coming all the way back to go to the outside world. But also, because when you get into the system with a standard VPN, you're not saying that you're, when you've logged in, you've got like a situation where you've got over-entitlement. So people are able to see systems on your environment that really they don't really need access to. And if you can think about it, that if they can have access, all it would take is someone to compromise one of those accounts and an external threat to get access to your system. And you know that's where breaches happen. But also, as I kind of touched just then, with this digital era we're now going into and have been going for a few years now, the whole cloud migrations become more and more common and more and more needed. However, in this environment we have here, it's less secure and more complex to implement. And that's where zero trust network architecture comes in, or zero trust network access. With ZTNA, it removes the need for you to connect to your via VPN and go through your firewall. Instead, we authenticate a session between the user's sanctioned device and the required applications or resources. And this is based on a predefined set of variables, things like your device type or your security posture. So in other words, have you got the latest malware definitions? Do you fit a certain security settings for your company? But also, is your software version, so is your Microsoft environment or your Mac environment up to the latest version? Have you applied all the patches? Things like time of day, but also this is in context of a user's job role. So it's as they are today, not as they were a few weeks ago or back in time. So it's up to date. And if there's anything that's changed in time, it gets implemented. But what this gives us though, is the removal of that reliance on the office bandwidth. Because yes, when you connect, you're having been authenticated and given that information. But when you're accessing the different cloud environments, you're going straight there. So you're not having that bottleneck of going through your traditional on-premise equipment. But also, it secures the access just to the right resources, but also renders everything else on the network invisible. What I mean by this is, so if we look at the picture here, so you're getting using applications in Google. But what that does, it says, okay, right, you have access to there, but I'm not letting you see anything else within my environment. So you're removing that risk of someone getting onto the Google environment, but don't see anything else in your environment. Like I say, that removes that overprivilege. But also, dynamic assigning of access rights enables the secure adoption of modern application architectures. But also, just an aside topic of this, we've also seen a lot of companies are seeing ZTNA as a good replacement for their WAN technologies, because it removes a lot of reliance on all of that expensive equipment, but also because you're going point to point via the internet, you haven't got to go back to your office to go out to different places. It's faster, it gives a better experience for the users. But we also think a great one here is that it gives us the ability to control what third parties have an access to on your network. Because if you've got a machine that you've got a secure, say, like your support company is going to connect into, in a traditional VPN world, they theoretically can see everything else that's on your network. In the zero trust world, they can only see the thing that you're given access to, so that resource or service. And now to MDR, or managed detection response. This has kind of, as a theory, been around for quite a while, but we're seeing more and more companies now starting to adopt this, because buying the individual bits and trying to bolt them together is getting more and more expensive, and you're wasting time and effort on things you don't need to. So what an MDR platform will give us is being able to feed your IT infrastructure into an EDR, which is endpoint detection response, but also your NDR tools, so things out of your network detection response, sorry, which is also, they're checking your network to see if there's anything suspect going on. So what you're doing there is you're taking your endpoint, so what used to be malware protection back in the day or local firewalls, and you're getting those bits of information into the endpoint detection response, so the EDR. And then that goes into the SIEM. So that passes that information, gets rid of all the stuff that we're really not interested in, because whether someone switched their machine on and off is not really that interesting. However, if they've tried to access something that is infected or tried to send something out of your environment, that could be something through data loss. Well, we are interested in that. So what we do is we only pass the information that's useful, and that will go into a seam. And so what this gives us at the end of the day is gives us actually insights to what's happening in your environment. Because we go back to what we said before, you can't really fix what you can't see. But it also gives the ability to kind of give that freeing up of teams. So you're able to concentrate on the things that you're supposed to be concentrating on while minimizing the cost. Because as I say just now, you're not feeding all of your information in, you're just feeding the important information in. And so what does MDR give us? Well, it gives us the best of breed technology. So like we were saying with the endpoint detection and response, so the old, what used to be in the old world, just a bit of malware. Now this is a complete set of products on your machine. So your local firewall and your malware. You've got your MDR, which is endpoint detection response. So that's monitoring what the traffic is going across your network. And as our network and boundaries are increasing all the time, this is becoming more and more important. But the SIEM, so security information event management, gives us the ability to take all that information and display it and alert in a very clear and structured manner. And with the detect element,
to interrupt you, I've just wondered if we could break that down into even more simple terms. I'm conscious that we've got quite a lot of people on the call who maybe don't have a huge awareness in some of these terms. And when we say endpoints, we're literally talking about laptops, aren't we? Laptops,
yep, so
mobile phones, the tech that your individual staff are using. Is that right?
That's correct. Yeah, it's literally anything that you connect to. So if you've got an on-premise server, that will be an endpoint. If you've got a laptop, a phone, a tablet, any of these things, they are things that can be targeted. So there are endpoints.
So they're all being monitored, is that right?
Yes. Anything that happens on those in terms of with the local firewall. So if you're trying to go to a certain website, these things are recorded. Most of the time, it's not really that important, the stuff that's not really an alert. But in the old world, we'd generate all that information into the SIEM, so Security Information Event Management System. All that information would go in there, and it's a lot of information coming in, which costs money. And so what we're doing is we're stripping out all the things that we really don't need to know about. So like I say, you've logged in this morning and that's the same as you do every day and there's been no mistyped passwords or any of that kind of stuff. Well, that's fine. Well, everybody forgets their password or mistypes the password, but we don't need all of that information going into the SIEM. But if you entered it in five times within 30 seconds, you think actually that could be someone trying to crack your password or get into your system. So an alert would be sent into the SIEM, then we could raise that and deal with it accordingly. But with a network detection response, what that does, it sits on your network and monitors the traffic. So say, for example, you're downloading some emails or downloading some data and you've put it onto your machine and then you've sent a whole load of stuff back out. Well, that, you know, most cases that's completely safe and everything's fine. No one's really worried about it. But sometimes it could be evidence of data being exfiltrated from your environment, so data loss, and that may need to be acted upon. So we could alert on that as well. And
like
that could be anything.
So like Maxine was saying with CRM, yes, yes, and CRM use being so important, maybe you might see someone downloading the entire database from your CRM. That I'm assuming would be a little bit of a worrying flag.
That could be a red flag, yeah. Anything like that. So under normal behavior, so your anomalies, we would pick up and then report on. But ultimately, with all these tools in the system, you need something to be able to manage it and give you information and alerts that are clear and descriptive of what's actually going on. Because if you ever looked, which I suggest you don't, but if you ever looked at a syslog coming out of an environment, it is pages and pages of just text. Well, all those bits of text mean something, but unless you've got time and a very keen eye, you're going to miss a lot of the stuff in there. And so what the SIEM is going to do is pick out the relevant points and report on them. And so it does the strain so you don't have to. And as we say, it frees up the time for you to do the things you want to do. But also the fact, if you're trying to look through a SIEM log, you will miss stuff because you come blind to it after a while. If you see the same thing on 40 pages, it all looks the same. But that's where the SIEM comes in, because it takes that information and reports on it. And so you don't have to go through those bits of information.
Cool, thanks.
In terms of detection, so this is quite an important area. So we've got the product sitting there, the EDR, the NDR, and the SIEM. That's doing all that information. It's seeing things, it's reporting on them. But also, say, for example, something does happen. Well, you need to have a system that's going to help you hunt those threats and then detect and monitor what's going on. But as we know, 9 to 5 doesn't exist anymore, because being a sort of global businesses nowadays, it is 24/7. And that is quite crucial, that this system is running 24/7, continually monitoring. So if at 2 o'clock in the morning, there's some breach that's been identified or some malware that's come out, well, we know automatically, because with the actual threat intelligence that feeds into the systems, it's quickly updated. So we're looking out for these problems. But also, it's the response of how you deal with it. So in all cases, or most cases, sorry, the reporting element's going to be fine. You've had this many people try and access your system. They've been blocked. Great, that's fine. But you also want to see is what's not being blocked, because they're the bits that could be the issue. And it's how we respond to those instances is crucial. But even when you're looking back, unless you have log retention and the ability to search on those logs, these things might have been happening for months and you've not known about them. But if you can go back and look and see through history, so say, for example, not just with security, but if you've had a server somewhere within your on-premise kit and it's been running out of memory, or even in the cloud, it's been running out of memory, well, the patterns develop. So you need to see that actually that particular server has been running out of memory every Thursday or every Friday. Oh, it just happens to be the day I send out all my mail shots out or something. Well, you can quickly draw up patterns and you can mitigate those issues and deal with them before they actually become a problem. And now we come to everyone's favorite subject, which is cyber insurance and regulation and compliance. Protecting your environment through your environment in your organization through insurance and compliance isn't just a simple tick box. A lot of companies think, actually, yeah, I've got my insurance now. Well, that's great. But unless you follow up and actually implement what you've committed to in your assurance, that can become invalid when you actually need it. So it's great, you know, it's really good that people are taking it. But if you're not doing the things that you're committing to within it, you could soon find out that you don't have the insurance you think you have. But also going through the implementing the basics of cyber essentials will give you a really good understanding, or even a baseline, of where your cybersecurity health is. From there, you can build on it and then identify your priorities of what particular area of your environment you should really be securing first. Or if you have things in place, are they really up to scratch? Because as we were saying earlier on, with the whole change of how we work and where our resources are now kept, a lot of what was in place 2 years ago isn't really servicing the need nowadays. But this will also minimize the risk of malware infections, because if you've got your endpoint detection in place and it is correct and it's working, everything else, it's got the latest definitions, well, that's going to cut your infections down. But also with your training, you'll have looked at the phishing attacks. And so you now know the sort of things that will be targeted to you and know what to look out for. But the crucial thing here is that if other customers, other companies and your customers see that you're taking your cybersecurity seriously, it really will build that confidence with your supply chain. And also another thing we've found ourselves, that if you're putting it in these different elements of the security kind of cyber essential areas, things like your DMARC, your brand protection, it's actually becoming more and more important. A lot of the bidding and procurement portals are insisting on evidence from your industry's compliance. So if you've not put certain things in place, which is things your industry standard want, well, you're not going to get onto those portals and you're not going to be able to be accessing those platforms. And as we kind of mentioned earlier on, an increasing number of industries are now making elements of cyber security mandatory. So like I briefly touched on earlier, Google and Yahoo, since February this year, have insisted that you have some kind of control and management of your outbound emails. And so by this, I mean that who's sending from your domain name. So in our case, redhelix.com, co.uk. Well, that is crucial to make sure that only things that you want to send out from that are allowed to send. Because as when we run this for a client we recently onboarded, there were a whole number of things that were still sending out from their domain, which they thought they'd killed those services 18 months, 2 years ago. So, you know, you've got to be very careful, but also the fact that don't be fooled by thinking that I don't really email that many Gmail accounts. It's people who are using the Google and Yahoo platforms as well. But also you've got the PCI SSE, which is credit card payments and handling those payments. From March next year, you have to have DMARC in place. That's mandatory. That's not something that is one of those nice to have that computer companies and cybersecurity companies are sending out. This is something you really do need to put in place. But finally, on these mandates that come out is the Digital Operational Resilience Act, or DORA to the rest of us. From Jan next year, you have to have DMARC in place, as well as a whole other areas of security. And this is something that's coming in as well. And there's a lot of information around DORA on the NCSE website, which Michelle mentioned earlier. These things are still there. So the Data Protection Act, GDPR, they are still there. You still have to look after your data and make sure that it is up to date. So this hasn't changed. It's still there and it is getting harder. But unfortunately, the rules are still staying the same. Thank you very much for that. And thank you for listening.
Lovely. Over to Michelle. Thank you very much, Jason. No, I thought that was really interesting, even for me. And I've heard a lot of it before, but it's interesting how quickly things are changing and evolving, especially in terms of regulation. So that's good to hear. We have had a couple of questions come in, and it's not too late. We've got a couple more, you know, a little bit of time left. So if you do have a question, by all means, you can submit it now. There's a Q&A section at the bottom of your screen. But so far, we've got a question in terms of where to start. So if I'm not doing any of this, then what should I do first?
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole host of things you can do and spend money on. But first off, come to us, have a chat about what you've got in place at the moment. And then with you, we can work out where your priorities lie, because it may be you've got remote, you need to secure straight away, or you might, everything you have might be in the cloud, so your existing VPN is not what really fit for purpose. Well, we can help you identify that. And the same with the security training, the cybersecurity training and awareness training. This is really a crucial thing to have in place, because that's what you're saying. If you're not aware of what to look out for, then it's quite easily to get compromised and fall for those phishing attacks, because they do look very realistic. So like I say, come back to us, have a chat. We can talk through where you are within your current journey. If you're right at the very beginning, we can help you get onto that journey and help you roadmap to where you want to be.
Yeah, and actually something, Jason, you're right. I mentioned it, you've mentioned it. The NCSE website really is a great resource. If you're a very small organization, if you are a sort of small recruitment agency and you're not sure what to do first, I would say check out that website. They have a lot of free resources, even if you are small enough, some free training that you can access. And as I say, there's that DMARC checker is relatively new, but it's free and it's easy to use, so definitely check that out. And that's interesting actually, because the next question is saying sort of, I can see how this is all useful, but what if I don't have the budget? How much is this going to cost me? And that's interesting. I guess that speaks to your point as well, Maxine. Budgets are tight. You need to control your controllables. But if you don't have the budget, what can you do, Jason?
Yeah, thanks, Michelle. There's a number of things we can do here. The whole MDR, this service, isn't actually as expensive as you think if you bought the piece, the puzzle individually, and then managed it and looked after yourself. That can be quite expensive, but if you take an MDR service from us, for example, it can be as little as £9 per month per user. So from that, what you're getting is, first off, your endpoint protection to make sure that all your different devices, whether it's your servers, whether it's your laptops, your phones, your mobile devices, making sure they're secure, but also making sure that the information that's going across your network, make sure that's secure. Then on top of that, we have the SIEM element, which is to monitor all those different bits and give you those reports and insight about what's actually going on. So as I say, it's not as expensive as you would think. So from around sort of £9 per month per user, you're getting a very good comprehensive service.
No, that's great. That does sound more achievable. So that's wonderful. Okay. We haven't had any fresh questions come up, but all of our email addresses are on the screen now. I've also made a recording of the webinar, so I'll send that out personally, and then you'll have my email address. You should already have it, but you'll have it again. So if you have any questions, if you're sat there this afternoon thinking, I wish I'd asked this, just send me an email. I'll direct it to the right person. I might not know the answer, but I can certainly find out who does know, and we can come back to you, answer any questions that you have. And really, I think just our advice to you is just to start thinking about this and to really start asking questions, looking at what more you could be doing, because the more you do, the less attractive a target you become for the cyber criminals, and ultimately that's what we want to help you achieve. So reach out if you have any questions, and all that's left for me is to say thank you very much, Jason, and thank you, Maxine.
Thank you.
Thanks.